This is Ham Radio Now, episode 244. Parity in Missouri. I don't know. Let me get this out of the way. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Arvin, over my shoulder. Chief Financial Officer, HamRadioNow.tv. Get something out of the program, stop there. And Arvin says, for this program, he wants to disclaim and deny any association or affiliation with the Ham Radio Now program. And please take me off the shelf. So we're done with that. What's going on? I got a phone call this morning from a person who wanted to speak to me off the record. And it involved the program that I did. Let's see, this one here, 241, Parity in Missouri, sorry. I'm pronouncing that wrong. I'm pronouncing it like everybody else in the world, but Missouri. Talked to Larry Scantlin, KEØKZ, about the Parity Act that is going through the Missouri legislature, which is all true, all fact. It is happening. The person that I talked to on the phone, again, the idea was to be off the record, and that's a bit of a problem because it means I can't talk about it at all. I'll talk about this in a moment, what that all means. So I convinced them to say, well, if you want me to do something about this, something is going to have to be at least on background, if not on the record. So nothing is going on the record. What is going on background is that as they say as we journalists say, a person familiar with the matter, and I'm getting a note from the producer saying that journalists just called and they said, what do you mean we? In the journalism business, in the real journalism with a capital J business, there's this thing called persons familiar with the matter. In other words, people who know what's going on but won't speak for attribution, background stuff. Details coming up. A person familiar with the matter said that all was not exactly as was discussed in the program. Not everything was completely true. Larry and I talked about a lot of things. There's the bill, which you can read. It's true. There's the stuff that it took to get there, and there's the hearing that he had, and or that the Missouri legislature had that he was part of and section manager was part of. They had an expert witness. He testified, and Ward Silver was there and testified. And Larry said it all went well. You can watch the program. Perhaps you have watched the program. Maybe you haven't watched it yet, or you can listen to the program. I've been at somewhat of a conflict as to whether I want to take this down because, you know, it's like now I've got an authoritative person saying, I wouldn't do this for just anybody who's nobody and says, yeah, I don't like what you said there in that program. No, this person who is familiar with the matter is familiar with the matter. And so I think, well, should I take it down? And the answer is no. It's a good program. The information there is useful. It is now a matter, some parts of it are in matter of at least some dispute. I called Larry, talked to him on the phone just a few minutes ago, and asked him, told him that somebody, that I couldn't tell him who it was or exactly what it was that they were disputing, that they said that not everything was completely true. And so as we spoke on the phone, he says, no, it pretty much stands by what appears in the program. The results of the hearing, which we presented is pretty much the alderman, not the alderman, the representatives in the Missouri legislature asked questions. Not all of them were favorable. Not all of them liked the whole idea. We said that some people didn't like it, but they got a generally favorable impression of what was going on. So, you know, that is in the eye of the beholder, but there were several eyes beholding it that, at least from Larry's point of view, things went well. I feel like my hands are tied in saying very much more about this because of the off the record nature of the phone call. but more will come out. We'll talk. This should appear more later. So I did need to make a program letting you know that, you know, not all is as sunny and light as it appeared to be. So now that I've talked about what I can talk about, let me talk about not being able to talk about what I can't talk about. Journalism with a capital J. I took a whole semester of journalism in a junior college that I attended in Central Illinois. My favorite class of any college class that I took. And I went to junior college, by the way, because I graduated from high school in 5.5 years with an F+. And so while I wanted to go to Northwestern and study Northwestern University in a Chicago suburb of Evanston, and we applied there, and study television broadcasting and radio broadcasting and journalism and stuff like that, they said, F+? Not a chance. So I got into a small junior college, which is sort of a way of saying that it's the place you go when you graduate high school with an F+, and they'll take you because your dad can afford to pay the tuition. So that's where I went. So I, in my defense, and in between finishing high school and starting with junior college, because I went to real college afterwards, you know, full 4-year college afterwards, went to Loyola University of Chicago, which, by the way, I never graduated from. There's a lot of forks in this conversation. I never graduated from Loyola because the summer after I've completed my junior year, was heading into my senior year, I had completed all the credits, all the required credits for my major, which was radio, television, and production, communications. And so all I had left were electives. You know, it sounds cool, you know, basket weaving and, you know, skate through stuff. But I got a job. I got a real job in television. I got a job running audio and then learned editing at a company called Edital, thanks to a mentor, George W9AUM, who was the chief engineer. And it was a new little startup, a boutique television production company. And they needed somebody who could turn the dials and, you know, make the audio stuff work. The industry has progressed long since then, but that's what I was qualified for. Lots of overtime. I signed up for evening classes at Loyola to finish my degree. I might not have been able to finish it in just one more year. Might have taken two. Turns out, with so much overtime, I never made it to class. So I withdrew before they kicked my butt out. I did just a withdrawal at the last possible minute and never went back. And pretty much never regretted that decision. My career has been a good one. Where the heck was I? Journalism class and school and stuff. So I took this journalism class in Lincoln College, Lincoln, Illinois, 2-year school. Now it's a 4-year school. Go wild Lincolns. Go Lincoln Pennies. Not sure. I'm not a sports guy. The journalism class was fantastic. The instructor worked for a newspaper. Back then, newspapers were the capital J in journalism. This was the early 1970s. You know, television did journalism, and there were some journalistic standouts in television, but newspapers were the capital J. Newspapers and news magazines, Time, Newsweek, Business Week, things like that. They were the capital J. I really loved that class, and I took that in my very first semester there at the college, and that is why I changed the results of my schooling from graduating from high school in 5.5 years with an F+ to, never graduating college, but being, given unsolicited small, grants and, not grants is not quite the right word. They give you some money. I forget what my vocabulary has failed me. Give you some money toward tuition. Initiated in Phi Beta Kappa. Phi Beta Kappa is the honor society for the 4-year schools. And Phi Theta Kappa is the honor society in the 2-year schools. I didn't ask for it. They just inaugurated me into it. My GPA out of 4 was, when I finished at Loyola that last year, it was a 3.5 something. So pretty good. I got A's and B's and one C, and I'm still pissed about the C. You know what the C was? Poetry. Poetry. But I owe a lot of my ability to succeed in college to that journalism class, because it taught me to write. One of the biggest bugaboos I had in high school was the inability to write a, quote, research paper, English class, you know, any kind of thing that, that required a little bit of studying and putting together some information from whatever sources you could, original sources or whatever, and then regurgitating it. If there's any English teachers out there in the audience, they're probably going, regurgitating it. Making it different enough that you're not plagiarizing the sources that you learned from, but saying pretty much the same thing. And as a high school student, some of you, but not most of you, have enough experience to put your own spin on things. Those of you that do, you're going to become political consultants and you're going to do very well. So journalism taught me to write. The ability to write taught me, and research and understand things taught me to do everything else in college. And so in the papers that I did in college, the research papers and whatever, I learned that what they really want was a magazine article, not a research paper. And that's what I knew how to write. And so that's what I wrote. And lo be praised, I got A's. I did a paper for, it was a political class, I guess. It was on propaganda. And I wish I still had a copy of it. I haven't seen it in decades. I probably, you know, it's not in any of the papers that I've got now. So I didn't husband and didn't take care of the stuff that I created back then well enough, even the things that meant a lot to me. I did this paper. We were supposed to do a research paper on propaganda. And propaganda is not necessarily what you think it is. It's a lot of what you think it is, but it is not completely necessarily what you think it is. I mean, if you say the word propaganda, you probably think, oh, you know, good old Soviet Union, Communist Party, and, you know, the crap that they put out about how wonderful everything is there when things are falling apart. So yes, propaganda has got that component to it, but that's the thing everybody thinks of. But propaganda is really just presenting a picture, presenting a story that is generally pretty much one-sided. It's your side. And so I wrote a research paper called The Propaganda of Amateur Radio and looked at what ARRL put in QST and CQ and 73 Magazine. And, you know, they say, write what you know. And I'd been a ham for a little while, and those are some of the things that I knew. I can't tell you what I said about those things because I don't have that paper anymore. But what I do remember about it is when I got it back, and I didn't know how well it was going to be received. I thought, you know, this is pretty good, and I'd become a halfway decent writer. I've had stuff published in QST. That's pretty cool. It came back A plus, plus, plus. Amazing. Awesome. And I'm going, I got something. I got something here. I've got a talent. I've never exploited it to its logical degree, but there was a bit of a talent there. So I love journalism. I just never had whatever it takes to put 100% of my effort and interest into doing journalism with a capital J. So now here I am, pretending journalism with at least a small J in this era when journalism can be anybody with a blog. You know, what is a journalist? We don't license journalists in the United States. Some countries do, but we don't because we have freedom to some extent, to a pretty great extent. Not as complete as, you know, kids are led to believe as they're learning government in school, but we have a lot of freedom. And so we don't license journalists. Your journalistic credentials and credibility come from a few different sources. If you're hired by a company that has journalism credit and credibility and authority. The New York Times, the Chicago Tribune, ABC, NBC, CBS Television. Yeah, you're a journalist. If you write a blog, maybe not so much. If you do a Ham Radio Now TV show, yeah, probably not so much. But anyway, here I am in the journalism thing. And some of the journalistic precepts still apply to some extent. And one of them is this concept of being on the record, being off the record. I don't get a lot of requests for doing things off the record. And I was listening to one of my favorite programs, radio programs. Now I listen to it as a podcast, but it's still on the radio on NPR called On the Media. And there was an interview just this weekend with a journalist who was doing some political story. And she said that she was getting information from one of the political campaigns that they wanted to be off the record. And they would call up and say, well, I'll give you something off the record. And she said, no. I don't want to hear it. I don't want the off-the-record information. And they said, well, but it's important stuff. He said, well, yeah, but I can't attribute. If it's off the record, let me show you something here first before let me get the definitions clear. This is from the Associated Press. And, who do you want to get your information from, definitions and things like that? Everybody can argue, but the Associated Press is a pretty good source. On the record, information used with no caveats, quoting the source by name. Off the record, the information cannot be used for publication. Somebody says this is off the record. I can't say here is what somebody told me, but I can't tell you who it is because there's a different definition for that. Background. The information can be published, but only under conditions negotiated with the source. Generally, the sources don't want their names published, but will agree to a description of their position. AP reporters should object vigorously when a source wants to brief a group of reporters on background and try to persuade the source to put the briefing on the record. Background briefings have become routine in many venues, especially with government officials. And then one I wasn't really very familiar with until I looked this up. Deep background. Information can be used, but without attribution. The source does not want to be identified in any way, even on the condition of anonymity. So the guy that I was talking to wanted to be off the record, which means I couldn't have done anything about it. So we got to the point of saying, okay, we'll say that the information in the program on Parity in Missouri, was not completely true. Far from completely false. A lot of true information in it. Not completely true. And so the heartburn that exists somewhere about that, I can't describe in any greater detail in this program today. Probably will. Maybe I will. Maybe somebody else will. Who knows where this will go from here. But it's not over with. It's just not, it's over with from the point of view of this program. Now we're just talking about journalism. So we got those on the record, off the record, background, and deep background. And that reporter that was in the On the Media program had said, no, I'm not going to accept any off-the-record information. You want to go on the record, you want to go for attribution, I'd be glad to talk to you, but I don't want anything off the record. And I am, this close to making that myself. When the phone call came in and it was, this is off the record, there's this thing in the back of your mind that's going, hey, somebody wants to tell me a secret. I like secrets. I like knowing stuff nobody else knows. But what good is a secret if you can't tell people you know a secret? And what good is there in having a secret that only you know that you know? So it becomes a bit of a problem. So I'm thinking, and the other part of off the record is, if people tell you stuff, unless you keep scrupulous notes about what they've told you and what is on the record and what is off the record, you're likely to screw up at some point and divulge off the record information or not quite so consequential, but still, you know, not great, is keep things to yourself that otherwise could have been told to the audience, that that can be on the record, but you just forgot. So, you know, I don't want this stuff swimming in my head as to what I know, at least as far as somebody said, that is off the record, and I can't tell anybody. In journalism with the capital J, when you get off the record information, the thing that you can then do is go find someone who is willing to be on the record about it. If the person you were talking to is not willing to be on the record, well, you probably know someone else who's involved or has information. You can go do some more digging and searching. And at some point, I probably will. I did talk to Larry, and I attempted to talk to a couple of other people that were involved in it, but time is limited. And I didn't get any calls back. I'm watching my phone right now for somebody to call back, but it's not happening yet. And my time is limited because I just finished the two programs on from Tapper, Ward Silver's banquet talk on Ham Radio Now. What? Ham Radio Now. What? No, I wish he could do that. Ham Radio Now. What? And on the 3D printing stuff from Steve Bible. So those two programs they're sitting on the hard drive on this system here. There it is. They're sitting on the hard drive there, waiting for me to push over to the editing system and edit them and this and get them all online, which I've got to do before 6 o'clock. This is going to be tight. It's 3:30. This is going to be tough. Cause it's Sunday, it's Super Bowl Sunday, and I'm in North Carolina and the Carolina Panthers are in the Super Bowl, and I'm going over to Jeff AC40's house, and we're going to go watch that. Excuse me. Came back from skiing with a cold and just starting to shake it, and it is sitting in the respiratory system now. You might be able to hear a little bit of it. You heard it in the past couple programs. You might be able to hear a little bit of it. I do have the Barry White voice going on here, but I often have that. Wish I had it all the time. Where was I? Now I've chased a rabbit down a hole so far, I don't remember where I was. So I'm this close to saying, let's just say it. Let's just make the decision right now. If you've got something that you want to tell me and you want it to be off the record, don't bother calling. Don't sidle up to me at a ham fest. Don't come to me at a club meeting. Don't communicate with me in any way something that you want to be off the record. Is there a letter designation between lowercase and capital? You know, I'm not sure, but if there is, that's the J that I'm looking for. As a journalist, I don't want the off the record stuff. This may be hard to stick to, but don't tell me anymore. If you're not ready to go on the record with it and on the show with it, then, you know, I don't want to know. The other thing about the timing is not just this Sunday, but as soon as I'm done with all this stuff, I got to pack up and head to Orlando because I'm going to Orlando. Yay. Things have been good enough to be able to go to Orlando and shoot whatever it is that I'm going to get to shoot down in Orlando. So, yay. So now a couple of other interesting things about doing that. I have a booth. It's a two-person booth. Oh, I was gonna dial something up here about the booth. And it's gonna take me a moment to get, so I will make an edit and then we'll go look at something together. So edit. Okay. Here's what I was looking for. This is all the way back at episode number one of Ham Radio Now, the Orlando Hamcation Tour. And what I'm looking for is a look on video of the booth. And I knew I'd been by where the booth is going to be, but and I caught it on video. And I thought it was best shown in episode one. And it turns out not. Must have been some other episode that I took a walk down some aisles. But it does appear here. So let me do it like that so I can look over my shoulder at it. And I'm going to play it a little bit early because I'm really impressed with myself in how I made this on-camera appearance in my very first show, having not spent a whole lot of time doing on-camera stuff. Here's what I did.
If you've been by my website, you've noticed that I have adopted a little pig as a mascot, and I have named him Arvin. And what we have here, rotating around that pole, is Arvin, the flying pig. And now, if I can work my way down this aisle, we're in commercial building 1 and 2. That's
okay,
the way they
so designated
here at the Orlando Hamcation.
That is,
this is Saturday.
There's unscripted, just ad lib. My ability to do an on-camera stand-up presentation like a typical newscaster guy. I think I did pretty well. And here's what I'm looking for. So over there on the right, coming up. Okay, hold it right there. And what I'm looking at is the booth that I've got. I think one of these doors here leads to the kitchen, and the booth should be right back along that wall someplace. And I haven't looked for this before. I don't know who that is that's in there now or was in there a couple of years ago when I did this video, but that's about where it's going to be. There's an air conditioner duct that they told me about was right over it. They said it might be cold. It might also be noisy. So I'm not sure that I'm going to set up the studio in a booth that I've done at some other ham fests. I'm not sure how I'm going to do this. I haven't had really enough time to plan it all out, but I may set up studio in a booth. I know I've got to record some forums and probably do some shooting, carrying cameras around at, around the ham fest, you know, just walking around looking for people and stuff. So we'll see. I'd like to be able to bring some people in. I'd like to be able to bring some ARRL officials in and talk about a lot of things. It's their national convention after all. But I don't have anything like that arranged in advance, so they may be they all may have fully occupied schedules. We shall see. Let me show you some stuff. I had to make a significant purchase of an extra camera. I like to have four cameras when I record a conference like I did at Tapper. And I ran into a problem at Tapper because this was one of the cameras that I was using. It says HD. It's a Sony camera. Put it in front of the, there we go, the micro cam. I got this camera out in Seattle, in fact, at a Best Buy, because one of the other cameras that I had taken out there, and all the other cameras all using videotape to record on. In fact, I've got one over here. Let me grab it. There we go. I know these are all going to look the same to you, aren't they? They all look exactly the same. But this camera runs on videotape, DV tape, and all the cameras that I've been using used tape. And oh, that's where the tape goes. It goes in here, and you might be able to tell there's a little piece of electrical tape over it, keeping me from springing it out, because this camera failed and wouldn't allow me to get the tape back in. But the tape mechanisms on these, very delicate, lots of moving parts and, you know, lots of stuff to screw up. So, but I, you know, I've grown up, I'm old. I've grown up in the videotape era of video. So I've always used tape for everything. So, and I considered, you know, tape is a good archive. When I've shot something, then the tape goes into a box and sits on a shelf, and it's the archive of everything that, that I've done. So that camera failed. All of the other tape cameras that I've had, except for the main one, the one big camera that I toted around every place, something failed. Typically it was the tape mechanism, and typically the thing that ejects the tape in and out. I've sent a couple of cameras back to Sony. They're expensive to repair. So I bought this camera, and this was the very first camera that I got that didn't use tape. It, records on an SD card. I don't think I've got an SD card in it. Yeah, the SD card is not in there, but a little SD card goes into the camera. And 64 gigabyte SD card, and it'll hold 6 hours worth of high quality material. And I've used this camera quite a bit, but beginning at Dayton last year, and then at the Tapper conference, I was noticing that the image that I was getting out of it wasn't very good, especially in lower light situation. It was practically standard definition. So if you watch the Tapper conference, on Saturday, I had this camera pointing at the slides, and the slides aren't that sharp. They're not terrible, but they're not that sharp. So I moved it to a less, and the cameras are important. The slides are important in the Tapper conference. So I moved it to a less important position, but all the positions are important. So this camera is being retired. It still works fine. I'd switch it to you, but I've taken it off the tripod so that I could show it to you here, so I can't switch to it. Using it in this program, it's still not, it doesn't match the other cameras in quality. So I needed another camera that was going to match in quality. But that camera did, one of the things that it did was teach me that recording onto a card medium was a good thing. 64 gigabyte card, you can sit there and record 5 hours straight without stopping. With the tape, I had to stop every hour, and in between all the Tapper conferences, and go to all four cameras and eject the tape and plug in a new tape and get it loaded up and start it again. And that delayed things a little bit. So with the tapeless cameras, I could start things first thing in the morning and then just change the SD card at the lunch break, and then again for the next day. So gathered up enough SD cards to have each camera have two for the 3-day conference, and that worked out pretty well. So I started acquiring more tapeless cameras, and actually this isn't the second one that I got, because the second one I got is the one that I'm looking into right now. And the reason I'm not showing it is I kind of need something to make this program out of. That had some specific requirements to meet what the old camera that I was using did. And I showed you this camera at on the road to Austin. When I stopped at Shelby, I showed you that camera. I'm sure you've seen it, so you're all set. But it needed a breakout system for professional XLR cabled audio. So that's what the camera I'm looking into has the capability of doing. This one does not. This one just has the typical little eighth-inch stereo audio jack. But everything else is pretty good on this camera. High-quality sensor, high-quality recording capability. These are big honking batteries that I put on them. They come with tiny little batteries that don't give you enough time. But these batteries run for hours and hours and hours. So I don't have to carry heavy batteries. These are what are considered today in the industry to be a heavy battery. When I got started in remote television stuff, the cameras were heavy. Even when we went to solid state sensors, the cameras were still heavy, and the batteries that ran them were huge batteries, nickel cadmium batteries that gave you about 30 minutes of life and weighed about 10 pounds. And you'd have to carry 4 or 5 of them for anything reasonable amount of shooting in the course of a day. We were always looking for some place to plug in the power supply, and we had to go on batteries. We hated it. But we did often enough. So no tape. Once again, the camera runs on solid state, on a card. This camera has internal memory. It's got like 96 gigabytes of internal memory, and then you can plug in the SD card. There we go. 64 gigabyte SD card. Oh, look what I can do. I can show you the other camera in the viewfinder of this camera. I think I can. Yeah, sort of. I'm juggling too many plates. So you can see the little thing on top. That's the XLR audio adapter to work on that camera. I know this isn't great, but you can see it. So SD card and internal memory and stuff like that. And it makes a really good picture. Real happy with these. But I needed one more. And so this is the next one that I got. This just came in the mail. The UPS from B&H Photo Video. And they're going to look exactly the same to you unless I put them side by side. And you can see minor differences. This camera, which I bought two of, is now, it's not obsolete, but it is not a current product. Can't buy a new one, not from B&H anymore. Anyway, so this one was actually a little bit cheaper. It doesn't have internal memory. Just going to run off the SD card, but the image quality is going to be pretty similar. In fact, it's, you know, being a little bit newer, it's got a mode of shooting that is more advanced than the other cameras, but I won't be using it because I want everything to stay compatible. It's got this huge lens, and should make some really pretty pictures. I haven't used it for anything yet because it just came in yesterday, and I'm still learning all the buttons that I've got to push. It's got a lot of manual. And I like everything that has manual capability. I will use a lot of automatics if I'm just walking around a hamfest, put almost everything on automatic. But if I'm shooting inside on a tripod in a controlled situation, I want all the manual stuff that I can get. So this has lots of manual capability. So I'm looking forward to using it, and I hope I can learn it well enough that I don't screw anything up too badly down in Orlando. So that was about $1,300. And this big honking battery, I bought another one of those to go with it. And I should buy one or two more. And they're like $125 if you buy them from Sony. I bought a couple of aftermarkets. They are okay. They are about an hour less of the 6 or 7 hours you can get off the battery. And the charging system isn't, you know, it doesn't work with Sony's fancy charging system quite as well. So I think I'll stick with Sony, even though it's a pretty premium price for the battery like that. So now I've got four nice looking cameras. And in addition to being able to do better conferences for ham radio, I'm going to start marketing myself slightly to local businesses around the Raleigh, North Carolina triangle area. To say, you want you got a company meeting coming up, you want it to look like it's been produced by CBS or ABC. I should say NBC. I should, because, you know, I used to work for NBC. I don't have a lot of corporate loyalty, but it's cool. So you want it to look like it was shot by NBC. Hire me and I can do it relatively cheap compared to other folks that are going to come charging in to do it. And again, I shoot them four independent cameras and I line them up and I do the switching in post-production, where if you screw up a switch, you can then correct it. It's easy. Just back up and try it again. You've got four isolated cameras. You might recall that I've got this system over here, this Wirecast system, particularly so that I can do live switching. And now I can only switch between these cameras and the micro cam, because the other two cameras are sitting here on the table. It's like, I can't switch them up right now. But I got that system specifically for being able to do live switching. And I've hauled it to some conferences. I've used it at Tapper twice, and I've used it to record shows at some hamfests. It's pretty big and bulky. You can't see the whole thing here, but this is a big box. You know, it's a Pentium i7 computer. It's a whole computer with a lot of stuff in it. And while it's roll-aroundable, I can take it with me. It's a little bit finicky, and I'm not real happy with the video quality that I'm getting through it. Still working on that. The quality that you're seeing right now has been slightly enhanced with filters in post-production. So, you know, I'm not real happy with what I'm getting out of it, considering how much money it cost. I kind of wish I had gone, instead of the Wirecast system, I'd gone to, I can't remember the name of the other company, the folks that Twit uses for their switcher and stuff. They've got some low-end stuff that probably would have been a little bit better. It's not Telex. Can't remember the name. Don't get old. Brain starts to turn to cotton candy. Anyway, taking four cameras with me and recording some forums and stuff down at Orlando and whatever else I can get put together, and may set up studio in a booth if that air conditioning system there. What am I want here? That one. This thing here doesn't turn out to be too noisy in the booth right below it. I've actually got two booths. I've got plenty of elbow room. So if you're going to Orlando, look for me. It's great at HamFest. A lot of people come up and say, I love the program, Gary. If I do set up studio in a booth, I may try to gather a few fans and we'll just do a show where we talk about whatever it is you want to talk about. You can tell me why you like the program. You can tell me how I should do the program differently. And I'll tell you that, no, I appreciate you being a fan. Appreciate your contributions if you're a fan to that extent and all that, but I'm going to do the shows the way I want to do them. Not the way you want me to. It's the way it is. It's a dictatorship. It's not a democracy. Have I covered everything that I need to cover? This is a sad show, in a way. But, you know, maybe not. If I were TMZ, if I were extra, I might revel in the idea that there's controversy about this Missouri Parity Act thing, because it's going to drive people to watch the show, clickbait titles and stuff. And I'm not a yellow journalist. I'm not much of a muckraker. Although I appreciate maybe not yellow journalism, but I appreciate the need for muckraking. I mean, certainly in politics and to some small extent in ham radio, there's a need for raking some muck because there is some muck out there. In the past in ham radio, Wayne Green filled that position, and he's been gone long enough and, you know, not really. There's people that write blogs, and there's people that do sniping on QRZ.com and Reddit or other places, but they're not very widely consumed. Wayne Green was pretty widely consumed, and people his opinions, his thoughts got out there pretty well, whether you agreed with them or not. I'm not really trying to be Wayne Green. First of all, I don't think I've got the gravitas. I don't think I've got the ability to reach that kind of audience. And Wayne was, bat poop crazy as well to some extent. So, he's dead now, so he can't sue me, and his estate probably will. I don't really want Wayne's reputation. He did a lot of things right, and he got a lot of things right and created a lot of good stuff, positive stuff in ham radio when the league was dragging its heels on things. But, I don't want to be the guy doing the spitballs all the time. I want to be respected. Capital J. We'll see. Let's end this and let me get this put together and we'll go watch, attention, Amanda Alden. Going to go watch Carolina beat Denver. Sorry. Hope that happens. This will be pretty dumb if it doesn't. So, Denver's coming limping into the Super Bowl after having just barely squeaked by. Who did they squeak by? Was it Arizona? No, I think Cardinals beat Arizona before that. So I'm not sure who Denver beat to get in. I'm not much of a fan. I'm a fair weather fan, and I'm a fan when local team is in the game. But they just barely squeaked by, and after being slapped by, what was it, Atlanta, in their only loss in the season a couple of games ago, Panthers came back and said, "Oh no, you don't. We're not overconfident. Watch this." Kaboom, 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 and they, pounded on Denver. Not a football fan. So we got Denver. No, it wasn't Denver because we're playing Denver in the Super Bowl. Lost all of. I had no sports credibility to begin with, and if you thought I had any, I've just lost it. And the way I really look at football is there was a disc jockey in Chicago that I've. well, certainly not a mentor. I've met him briefly once, and he made fun of the beard I had at the time. But I listened to him, and he changed my attitude about broadcasting to a large extent. You know, I grew up as in I guess what you might call the boss jock. You know, the big DJ, the big voice, the 89 WLS era of broadcasting. That's what I thought I wanted to be, but I could never quite pull off being 89 WLS. And then this guy came along, and his name is Steve Dahl, and he's been in Chicago most of his career, started in Detroit. And very laid back. I mean, he was considered to be one of the early shock jocks because he would say the word penis more often than anybody else on the radio at the time. Back when it was like, oh, did you hear what he said? But most of the time, the deal was he just called things as he see them, and he also did a very laid-back program. So laid-back that he would have guests on the program that didn't know that the on-the-air light had come on, and they were just bantering. They were bantering before the program started, or while a commercial break was on, and the bantering continued in not very much different style once the on-the-air light came on, because that's the way Steve did his program. It's very calm, very matter-of-fact, but with fairly strong opinions and making fun of a lot of things. You know, he liked making fun of a lot of things because a lot of things need making fun of. So that's, I don't do my program exactly that way, but he's a strong influence. So thank you, Stever. You'll never see this. How did I get there? Chasing another rabbit around the warren. Okay, so Amanda, lick your wounds. Carolina's stomping and romping over Denver. And I got to get this done before that game starts. So 73, I'm Gary Pierce, Scan4IQ, Arvin, Chief Financial Officer, HamRadioNow.tv. Click the pig. Over and out.